So the Supreme Court just said it's within the president's powers to issue a travel ban against people from other countries. Which would have been groundbreaking news if you hadn't heard of Jimmy Carter banning Iranians from entering the country, or George H.W. Bush banning people from Haiti. So yeah, this is about as precedent-setting as Charles Conrad. Who's he? Well, he's the third guy to walk on the moon, and probably the most relatable one, because his first words upon stepping down were, "Whoopee! Man, that may have been one small step for Neil, but that's one long one for me." Yeah, I could totally see myself saying that. Alright, so all this seems pretty set in stone. Why do we have to rehash this again? Well, one of the major questions was, can this guy?
Donald J. Trump is calling for a total and complete shutdown of Muslims entering the United States.
Ban people based on their country. Because, well, a religious ban is illegal. This led to a very long and complicated legal argument that I broke down in a previous episode. On today's episode of Supreme Court Saturday, we're talking Trump v. Hawaii. Oh man, first the volcanoes, then the president? When will Hawaii catch a break? Today though, we're talking about the outcome. Because
the US Supreme Court handed Donald Trump one of the biggest victories of his presidency, upholding his travel ban targeting several Muslim-majority countries.
Really? I mean, give the man some credit. One of the biggest victories of his presidency was banning people from a few countries most people probably can't even find on a map? Wow, even Jimmy Carter's thinking to himself, man, that guy has to pad his record a little. Now, if you're worried about how this might affect you, don't, because turns out this travel ban's actually been in effect since it was proposed. But hey, out of sight, out of mind, right? Alright. Before I reveal too many spoilers of what the opinions say, let's dive right in with Justice Roberts writing for the majority. He said, "The Immigration and Nationality Act vests the president with authority to restrict the entry of aliens wherever he finds that their entry would be detrimental to the interests of the United States." Well, this is gonna be a short episode. I mean, how do you come back from that? To go into a little more detail, in this case, the president's stated justification for banning those countries wasn't Muslims are scary, but rather, it was necessary to impose entry restrictions on nationals of countries that do not share adequate information for an informed entry determination. To some, this might be a reasonable excuse too, because something tells me Yemen might not be keeping the best public records of their people right now. Considering that, with the constant bombings and famine, I'm not sure people are taking the most adequate notes. Now, that statement probably irked a few of you for reasons we'll get into when we talk about the dissenting opinion. But for now, we're hearing the logic of the majority. In this case, Hawaii brought up two different arguments for why this case should not be considered constitutional. First, plaintiff's final statutory argument is that the president's entry suspension violates a different part of the Immigration and Nationality Act, which provides that no person shall be discriminated against in the issuance of an immigrant visa because of the person's race, sex, nationality, place of birth, or place of residence. Well, now I think Hawaii's right. Ugh, man, this is an emotional roller coaster. Justice Roberts, why is this wrong? Well, first, this again isn't precedent-setting stuff, as we've banned people from different countries in the past. But if you want a more boring and statutory reason, which I'm sure you're all clamoring for, I'm gonna give it to you. Although, I'm gonna paraphrase a little bit, partially because I'm not sure how to pronounce this symbol. The artist formerly known as Prince? Section 1182, the section Trump is using to define his travel ban, defines the universe of aliens who are admissible into the United States and therefore eligible to receive a visa. Once that section sets the boundaries of admissibility into the United States, this non-discrimination section prohibits discrimination in the allocation of immigrant visas based on nationality and other traits. That's right, you can only discriminate in a sweeping ban, rather than your more subtle and nuanced discrimination. Now, this brings us to the other big problem, the Establishment Clause. Plaintiffs further claim that the proclamation violates the Establishment Clause of the First Amendment, because it was motivated not by concerns pertaining to national security, but by animus towards Islam. Now, I think there's a very interesting argument to be had here that the Supreme Court just completely glossed over. Brace yourself, because, and I say this with all the respect I can muster, this argument's a little dumb. In a case arising from an alleged violation of the Establishment Clause, a plaintiff must show, as in other cases, that he is directly affected by the laws and practices against which his complaints are directed. There's an issue here because the entry restrictions apply not to the plaintiffs themselves, but to others seeking to enter the United States. You know, I wonder why they didn't just bring someone who was banned in the United States to come to the United States and serve as plaintiff. I mean, way to sidestep an otherwise super important and interesting constitutional argument. God, did I spend way too much time writing about that in my previous coverage. Roberts did go further, though, in the statutorial equivalent to O.J. Simpson's If I Did It, by saying that the proclamation is expressly premised on legitimate purposes, preventing entry of nationals who cannot be adequately vetted and inducing other nations to improve their practices. The text says nothing about religion. So this is, on paper, a legitimate national security proposal, and despite the fact that I had to read through literally pages of anti-Muslim and Muslim-banned things Trump and his friends have said before getting to that, the Supreme Court's job is not to view things in context. It's to judge whether the thing itself is constitutional. For example, if you steal food to feed your family, you're still stealing. So that's what the majority said. Now let's get fired up, because in reading her opinion, you can tell that Justice Sotomayor was not having it. It read like if you ran a 1 AM Trump tweet through a legal thesaurus translator. First, she said, it leaves undisturbed a policy first advertised openly and unequivocally as a total and complete shutdown of Muslims entering the United States, because the policy now masquerades behind a facade of national security concerns. And, well, maybe, but that makes it not unconstitutional. Then you can tell she started to get madder than an internet commenter discussing the Supreme Court case by calling out Justice Roberts hard. That alone suffices to show that the plaintiffs are likely to succeed on the merits of their Establishment Clause claim. The majority holds otherwise by ignoring the facts, misconstruing our legal precedent, and turning a blind eye to the pain and suffering that the proclamation inflicts upon countless families and individuals, many of whom are United States citizens. Justice Sotomayor, those are your co-workers. I'd say you're publicly calling them out, except, let's be honest, I'm one of 10 people reading this decision. But yeah, you have to sit next to them again tomorrow. Just make a passive-aggressive office memo like the rest of us. This dissent included an even longer list of all the anti-Muslim and Muslim ban-related things Donald Trump has done. It was all summed up neatly in one truly scathing review of the text that said, by blindly accepting the government's misguided invitation to sanction a discrimination policy motivated by animosity towards a disfavored group, all in the name of a superficial claim of national security, the court redeploys the same dangerous logic underlying Korematsu and merely replaces one gravely wrong decision with another. Korematsu, by the way, was that one time when the government saw Japan as a threat during World War II and decided to lock up all of the Japanese Americans. Now, in a truly momentous little side thing that came out of all of this, the Supreme Court, after 70 years, finally said that this internment camp ruling was wrong, making it no longer legal precedent. So, that's kinda cool. Well, there you have it. The court's opinion and dissent on this literally and figuratively divisive issue. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hey YouTube, if you want to support independent journalism investigating the Supreme Court, subscribe to our YouTube channel for our weekly Supreme Court Saturday episodes. Click here if you want to see an in-depth analysis of the case that led to this decision, and click here to see an episode that YouTube thinks would be best for you to watch. As always, leave me a comment if you think you have an important case that I should look into, and thank you for watching.